Good morning. I'm going to continue. Yesterday we were talking about the limitations, the limits of solar power technology, and the purpose of yesterday's presentation was to show that while solar power technology, I think, has a lot of advantage, it has some limitations that are intrinsic limitations of the technology. The idea is, and we saw that, and we will review that again a little, that at some point when you are going to very large systems, then the efficiency, the optical efficiency of the system, because of the cosine factor and other losses, is limited, so you have a large, not relatively good annual optical performance. And what we are going to discuss today is options to overcome these difficulties with the technology, to try to improve the technology. This is part also, I was referring yesterday that some of the work that I'm presenting is the work that was carried out, or started to be carried out, still being carried out, at the Australian Solar Thermal Research Initiative, that I was the director of the initiative for 4 years. And this initiative, the main goal of the initiative was to reduce the cost of concentrating solar thermal technologies just by technological means, not by the learning curve of the industry, just by changing the technology to come out with concepts that have the potential to really reduce the cost, and our goal was to reduce the cost 56%. I already explained in other lectures that we selected tower technology, the same way that NREL also selected tower technology for the SunShot program, that has the same goals, but let's say one order of magnitude higher investment in the United States. That we have our program was 80,000 million for 8 years. The program in SunShot was, I think, 100 million per year, or something. It's a completely different scale. But the goal was the same, was to reduce the cost by developing new technologies, and to reduce the cost substantially to get to grid parity, what they call grid parity. Both NREL and the consortium that we were in Australia, we came to the conclusion that if you want to do something fast, I'm not saying that the other technologies cannot reduce the cost. What we thought is that by changing the technology or improving the technology, the tower technology was the one that has the potential to, by changing the technology, improving, going to very high temperature, etc., by technological means, to come out with new concepts that will reduce the cost substantially in comparison to the current technology. Of course, you saw yesterday Professor Manuel Collares that he said believed that Fresnel technology could also be reduce the cost substantially. We thought that tower technology could reduce the cost faster. We're not saying that not all the other technologies could not also reduce the cost, but this, as I said, was the conclusion also of SunRel. And so all of these studies are under the framework of trying to come out with new concepts that will reduce the cost of concentrated solar thermal technologies more than 50% in relation to the current cost. We decided nasty solar tower technology, and then we also decided the power block was going to be supercritical CO2 power. One of the reasons I said is because it has the potential to have higher performance, and also it has the potential to scale down much better than this steam cycle. And this is a fact. This is a turbine, gas turbine, etc., scale down very well. You see that in the airplanes, etc. So this is that was one consideration, important consideration also, because in Australia we came also to the conclusion, talking with the authorities, etc., that the typical size of a power plant would be of the order of 25 megawatt. But in other places you see that the tendency is to go to 100 megawatt and larger plants. So to go to 25 megawatt, if you go with a steam cycle, you penalize the cost, the levelized cost of electricity, because a steam turbine of 25 megawatt has almost the same operational maintenance cost that a 100 steam turbine. But this is not the case with supercritical CO2. So supercritical, the little problem with supercritical CO2 power block is that they don't exist commercially yet. But in the consortium in Australia, we were also working with NREL, with Sandia National Lab, that already have a prototype working in Sandia National Lab in New Mexico. And also, we were working with several universities in Australia that were working directly on developing a small supercritical CO2 to bank. So that's one of the reasons of the selection. So in this framework, we have also a series of doctoral students, and we were asking different doctoral students to do different things. The challenge that we put to Clotilde Corsi, that is a doctoral student from Australian National University, was to study alternatives to the traditional solar power technology. And the main reason was this, that the traditional solar power technology, when you reach it, you go large in scale, the optical performance goes down, and then the rest, well, you can do better in the rest, but if you are already losing 40% of your energy just on the optics, it's not so good. So this is a part of her analysis to try to come out with new concept of solar tower technology that will have the potential to do better than the current concepts. This is, was a presentation that was delivered in Solar Paces last year in Chile, for the previous year, and was the starting of this analysis of the concept. As I said before, Professor Collares was talking yesterday about the nice feature of Fresnel technology. Well, this is almost try to capture the nice feature of tower technology and the Fresnel. So we are going back to the Fresnel thing in the other way. So, let's see. Let's go directly to the motivation. As I said, if you look at the typical cascade losses of a solar power plant, you see that you get the incident radiation is of the order of 15, whatever, I don't look too much about the units right now. Then you have heliostat reflectivity, cosine, shading and blocking, atmospheric attenuation, receiver interception or spillage, receiver absorptivity, and at the end you get the receiver losses, and you see that we have a lot of losses, and a very large fraction of those losses are optical losses. You have cosine, but that depends on the sun position, on the distance to the tower, on the tower height, the attenuation, that depends also on the sun position, distance to the tower, and tower height, shading and blocking, that depends also on the layout, on the how you distribute the heliostat on the field, and you have the spillage, that mainly depends on the sun position, distance to the tower and tower height. The mirror reflectivity, of course, depends on the technology of the mirror itself. We discussed yesterday that the main losses, optical losses, are the cosine and the attenuation. We also put the shadow of the receiver and the spillet, but we showed that was very little. You have to be careful with this axis because it's a tower height of 3,003 kilometers, which is a fall for a tower. But you still see that we saw the other day, that the optimum for different heliostat fields, and the larger the heliostat field, the more the optimum goes to the right, is that if you have very large heliostat field, the optimum tower, the optimum efficiency is on the order of, for tower of half a kilometer, if that doesn't make too much sense. You will stay in this, in the area between 250, then your long go above 70%, even for a small heliostat field. You can see this also here. This is a typical 150-meter tower. Well, what's typical now is the typical is 250-meter towers, or the last one that people are doing. But you can see this is the scale of the the best, just the optical, the annual optical efficiency, but the maximum optical efficiency you can get, just the cosine under the moisture, and you see that you get only above 85% in very small part of the area of the sun. So, well, a lot of people have stated that, and there is a nice study by my previous group from CNR, that they analyze all current, well, at the time, 2016, all current projects, and they saw that the annual efficiency, optical efficiency, was no larger than 60%. The density decreased with size because you have to space down more in order to avoid the blocking effects. The optical efficiency also decreased substantially with size. And this is not theoretical, this is based on the real commercial power line. So, we wanted to analyze, or we want to explore in this the concept of multi-tower. Instead of having only one tower, what happens if I have several towers? Well, the first thing that will happen is the system is going to be more expensive because I have several towers and several receivers, but the tower can be lower, can be shorter, so the receiver lighter and smaller, so it's not so clear how many towers it will be the optimum thing. We are not going to discover what is the optimum process here, so I don't want to raise a lot of expectation, but what we are looking here is what kind of concept could make sense or could... So there are, this thing has been studied in the past, and as Professor Collares pointed out yesterday, David Mills, was a professor from Australian National University, in the 90s, they did a lot of studies about, especially, this kind of multi-tower solar arrays, how would be the best configuration of a multi-tower solar array, considering, let's say, that arrays are almost infinity, just to base on the properties of the optical thing. Of course, they discovered or they pointed out that you can improve substantially the optical efficiency. More recently, there have been some studies about two multi-towers, and very recently, last conference in October, in Morocco, there were again a presentation I referred before in another talk about the Sledging by Sledging and Partner, about the European project that has looked into this technology, these two towers. This is what they were looking, something very similar to the one below. And they were the conclusion was that the advantages don't compensate the disadvantages. But as I said before, one of the assumptions was that changing the aiming point for a heliostat takes 20 minutes. I mean, this is too much. So this has been before. What we have tried to do is to not do things completely general or, let's say, very realistic things, to try to see, can we design a specific, concrete system and show that this system has better optical performance and can address the disadvantages that you will have with additional towers, additional receivers, and other disadvantages that I will discuss later. One thing that is important also to recognize is when Professor Collares and others, where they talk about parabolic trough technology, one of the advantages of parabolic trough technology is the modularity. Okay. You put a row, typically a loop is two rows connected in a U system, and they just it's like we are pointing here. You get the oil or the working fluid entering the loop, getting heated in the case of the parabolic trough in the receiver tubes, and then the heated oil goes to a pipe and is connected, and then it goes to the to a heat exchangers, or if the working fluid is directly in molten salt, you will go to the hot tank of a two tanks configuration. But the good thing with this is that the next loop looks exactly the same, and the next, and the next, and the next. So you will, of course, you have some losses when you the plant starts to be too big, because you have a lot of piping and the fluid moving a lot to go to the power block. But this is mainly the thing. The rest of the optical system and the system every loop looks the same. So if you know how to do a loop at a good price, then you can extend the thing. Even if it's becoming too large, you can put two power blocks, etc. So the modularity is a very good advantage of this. This is not the case, or not so clearly the case, with the tower technology. And we would like, in this kind of concept, we'll say, well, let's try to see if we can have a modular system. We want to develop a loop based on tower technology that can also be replicated in the same way that you would do with the parabolic block technology. So we decided to have several towers and several several receivers, and all of them connected through a piping system, so that the fluid goes from one receiver to the next, and then goes out of the loop. So our purpose is, can we design a loop that makes sense from the point of view of the optical point of view, from the point of view of the rest of the rest of the system, and it can operate properly. In this talk, what we are doing so far is improving the optics, and then we will discuss what are the problems with the thermal conversion, etc. So this is using the ideal concept of the ideal field that I explained yesterday, when the heliostat is just infinitesimally small. With this concept, what you are just saying is, if I put a heliostat, whatever heliostat at this point, the maximum efficiency I'm going to have is the efficiency that is given in the map. So we will decided to optimize the position of the receiver for the tower. We establish the tower height at 75 meters, because we thought that this is a convenient one. And it's not, let's say, it's relatively cheap to build 75 meter tower. And then we decided also to have six receivers for the purpose of also symmetry, etc. And the question is, we optimize the position of the receiver to maximize the area that has an optical efficiency larger than 90%. Okay. And you see that compare this, the same area that we're talking about with the previous one. This is the same plot. 600 minus 100 minus, so the same. You see, one tower, we get almost done, everything below 85. With this configuration, you already see that almost all the area is above what we get. So, of course, we get this efficiency also by aiming the heliostat that you put in any point here at different towers at different points of the day. Okay. So for instance, at the early in the morning, this will be the aiming strategy. The blue, all this area, this is the same area here, but that means that all this point that are in blue, all the heliostat here, are aiming to this tower. All these are aiming to this tower, etc. No? All these are aiming to this, etc. So you will see that, and this is the efficiency that you get at this point of the day. You are, now it's 10 o'clock. Well, this is, I did it for the city of Seville, 37. So we have a spring for something, and in this case, this concept has been developed by in the north, in the 37 degrees Celsius of latitude. Sorry, degrees north of latitude. And you see, this is for 10 o'clock, the efficiency at noon. This is a solar time. And you see also, the rest of the north, what are the typical configuration. And noon, this is almost each one of the plants are operating like an individual plant by themselves. In the winter, this was the previous one was for the summer. In winter, things are different. The efficiency is much larger in the beginning, in the winter, because the sun is lower and our tower is also lower. So you see, it's very good in the mornings. Again, I think it's very interesting, this part of the aiming strategy, how this section is changing. So this is the way we have computed this graph. The annual efficiency with the heliostat moving from one moment to the next from, well, not from one moment to the next, but moving during the day, aiming to different. With this, you can get a very nice efficiency at least in theft. Now, our goal was, well, okay, that's very theoretical, this is the upper limit that we can get. Now, how we build a heliostat field that achieve this, that achieve a real heliostat field with real heliostat that achieve this thing. So, we started to say, well, as it's interesting to put the heliostat, we are going to put the heliostats in the places that we have already identified, and if we put the heliostat, they will have very good efficiency. The problem is that our ideal heliostat don't have channels unblocking, and now I have channels unblocking and I need to space the heliostat there. And the this was the first approach, and we'll be presenting later another approach, is we start defining the region of the heliostat field, that is a good region that we have, we'll say, well, at least the theoretical efficiency, the cosine and attenuation is going to be more than 90%. So I know if I put the heliostat there, at least the cosine and attenuation is not going to be lower than 90%. Then any other losses would be the channel unblocking and the spillage losses that will, let's say, decrease the performance, but still, if I start locating with a good location, then and with the main losses, we expect to have a good efficiency for that. So we need to deploy the heliostat. So first, we get the boundaries of the heliostat. This is what we already done. Now we start to deploy the heliostat field there. But this deployment of the heliostat field, you have to do an optimization by putting the heliostat and having all of this aiming. Some heliostat will be aiming in one different direction, etc. To do this is tricky. You really need to, because the shadow of a heliostat over another heliostat depends on the position of the heliostat, and the position differs a lot. If one heliostat is aiming in one direction, another is aiming in another direction, the shadow that you cast. So you really have to do almost a 5 minutes simulation of the thing during the whole year. Try again, and try again, and try again. So we try to do it in a not using ray tracing, etc., because it was, so we try to do some approximation of this. Well, first the optimization, this is the first stage. We optimize the position, as I said, of the area where we're going to deploy the heliostat. And we did we fixed the height of the tower, and we just optimize the distance between the receiver and the loop. So this is 360 meters distance, and this is 412, is one of these. So, this was relatively easy. Then we need to establish a pattern how to distribute the heliostat on the field, and start looking mainly to the shadowing and blocking, because it's the next important factor, and calculate the annual efficiency. We said, well, as a first approximation, since we said that the current technology, the efficiency is less than 65%, so well, let's try to get a heliostat field of more than 70% efficiency, even if it's with a rough methodology. And then if we prove that this is the case, then we can prove that this methodology or this system can work, if we can improve the technology. So we started to, because it's a symmetry, we simplify the thing, we just have to position half of the field, and the rest will be complete. And the other thing that we said was interesting is we have different heliostat, different part of this region. You have heliostat that during the day you will aim to two receivers, to only to three receivers, or more than four receivers. So there are more complex regions in which you have to be more careful, because the shadow and blocking are more complicated than in others. And we did this analysis per region, and then we tried to improve the performance. Let's say, if you are only aiming to one receiver, or to two receivers, if you are only aiming to one receiver, we just do the typical optimization that is in the books, is in the papers, so there's no problem. You are aiming to two receivers, but 90% of the time you are aiming to one receiver, the same. The problem is when you are aiming to two receivers and 50% is in one receiver, etc. So, while we were working on this kind of things, we started with the biomimetic pattern. That is because we didn't, well, there are many things that you can get. The purpose was not to get the best optimization, because the purpose was to start to understand what are the big problems with optimization, what do we have to do to and start advancing on this. So we did this for all these different regions, and we were optimizing for each one of the regions separately what the, this performance. We did it by using shadowing and blocking an analytical tool, and we developed the whole optimization process in a language called Mathematica. I don't know if some of you know. It's a very nice prototyping thing, but well, it's not the, the fastest way that you can do. So we have some limitations, but the idea was to try to see if we can get some. And we got this areas that fill, that I will later model in Panatube, and but then we call this the Frankenstein heliostat, because you can really see different patterns and different things very clearly. And let's say you are really thinking that if you got a nice optimization scheme, I would like to see a more transitional, let's say a more smooth changing of the position of the pattern from one region to the other. So to me, it's clear that this is not the best, the final solution. But if you look, we have a density of more than 20% of ground coverage. That this is more than normal the conventional power plants. And double technology. And we have an annual efficiency of 76%. With real heliostat, this is not the idea. This is with real heliostat deployed on the place, etc. And the other interesting thing is that you see this is the azimuth and elevation and the amount of the efficiency, and for an elevation of more than an elevation of more than 20-30 degrees of the sun, and this is where the sun will get more energy, the optical efficiency of the field is more than 80% of that. So this was the first attempt, just to show that the concept may have some promising. One thing that I don't have here, I thought that they have it. One thing that we don't have, and we haven't analyzed, but we haven't started to analyze, is that during the day, the energy that is one of the receivers is getting, the varies a lot. So not all the receivers are subject to the same amount of energy. And this is a problem. You are not have a very well balanced thing. Still, the fact that you are connecting all the receiver with a one pipe, etc., may help, because you can bypass or do things with the changing the flow that goes from one receiver, etc., to guarantee some kind of. But this is something that we haven't completely studied yet. We haven't started. We are still working on moving from the Frankenstein field to a more optimized field. So, I'm going to show you now. Well, I think we have demonstrated that this may have at least improved the optical behavior, but still we have to improve the optimization of the receiver, the speed of loss, the receiver shadowing, and we need to, what I was referring before, to address the problem of the thermal loss. So we need also to incorporate in the analysis thermal considerations for this drastic variation of thermal loss, and also cost consideration, because when you start to have six receivers, etc., etc., you start to discuss this. Also, of course, when you start including the cost optimization, most likely you will see that perhaps the tower will go down, because if we do this analysis for 75 meter tower, but if you do for 50, you get a very similar result. Okay. And a 50 meter tower is better than a 75 meter tower. Okay. So, let me move to the next thing here. So that was 1 year ago, or half a 1.5 year ago. Now, Clotilde has continued working on the optimization, because as we said, the idea of the previous work was to demonstrate that just with a very rough optimization and this approach, you can get something that has better efficiency than the current technology. Now we need to improve the optimization to see how much we can get better, and also how complex is this optimization process, and then move, once we have, let's say, optimized optically the field, then we need to start addressing the problem with the imbalance of the losses, etc. But we wanted to have first a robust optimization procedure, because then we are going to, at the end of the day, we want to go to an economic optimization of the whole thing. But to have an economic optimization of the whole thing, we need to have tools that are that will help us to do this optimization in a practical term, and this is a trick. So this is the same thing, the motivation. You have seen this before, so I'm going just to skip it. The stage one was to get this maximized area. We have already seen that. So let's go. And this is what we got for the. So we are starting with the same problem, and now we are trying to do a different kind of optimization. Well, this is much more, let's say, we're improving in presenting, in presenting the thing. This is, as you can see, only one receiver. More than 91% efficiency, 0 square meters. 6 receiver, more than 91% efficiency, almost half a million square meters of the same region. So this is, let's say, this is the most important motivation. So now we are looking, let's say, before we distributed the field in regions, depending on how much energy the region was sending to different receivers. And we simplify the thing, is only Helios that's the main, is mainly participating or interacting with two receivers. We just focus on these two receivers and optimize this region for aiming two receivers, because we, well, it takes some time. So here we wanted to go to a more, let's say, robust optimization. So this is, we distribute everything in hexagonal cells, all the area of the field, and we are trying to optimize each one of the cells and have a process that is going to optimizing all the cells, because the cells will have a small number of heliostats, but and that will be fast enough, because still we are working in Mathematica. Mathematica is a slow thing, and so we will be able to optimize the whole cell for all the different aiming points. So, well, these are the characteristics of the heliostat. I didn't say these are the heliostat like the one that we have here, so a small heliostat from CSIRO, with azimuth and elevation tracking system. These are not having, it's a pitch and roll, this is not the same kind of. Why we selected azimuth and elevation? Because it's easier to calculate, and also because other important thing, these heliostats are aiming to different towers. The pitch and roll, this movement that we have here, has limited interaction. You cannot go directly in the opposite direction. So azimuth and elevation, you can do, let's say, you can increase the range, but you have to change the thing. Azimuth and elevation can aim in any direction. So this is one of the additional rationales, the simplicity of the equation, but also the fact that a heliostat that moves in azimuth and elevation can aim anywhere. While if you have these linear actuators, you have just a limited range where you can aim. Yeah. We are assuming that the focusing is ideal. This is another. Why we are using a small heliostat? Well, we are using a small heliostat because we are aiming to different towers, and aiming to different towers means to have different focal length. So you have a large heliostat, you're going to have problems with it when you change the focal length drastically. So the smaller the heliostat, the less the problem it is. This can be addressed also for large heliostat, and we have done it. We are also within ASTI, we developed the concept that of a heliostat, a large heliostat with many facets that can change, can move its facets individually. So this is a virtually a heliostat that you can change the focal length of the heliostat by software. Of course, you pay the price that you have many individual facets with many motors. We were using the electrical motor that you are using in the car, and in the bulk you buy is only 1 euro per motor, so it was not. We did an economical study. We were selecting, we have three teams to make the heliostat. We have three teams with different, let's say, competing inside the group. Three teams to come out with different heliostat concepts, and we selected out of them two, the one that had the better performance, and then only one. And this was discarded because it has less economical performance than others. But it was it's an interesting thing, and perhaps if that helped you to improve a technology that has a much higher efficiency, that goes back, because the difference between cost between the normal heliostat and this one was not too large. If you can improve, because using this heliostat you can have a different concept that will have a better overall efficiency, that go back to business as a commercial approach. So, reflectivity 100%, and the biomimetic, we go again with the biomimetic factor, with different with these two parameters. We decided, as objective function, we decided that we need to optimize the local efficiency of the. So for every cell, we selected the characteristic heliostat, and we optimize the performance of this cell, taking in account the Chadwick unblocking with respect to the other heliostat in the cell. Also to simplify the calculation, but it's something that Van Poel did a very long time ago for normal tower system, and it worked. You can get a good. Especially if the cells are small, the representative heliostat will give you a good idea of the performance of the rest of the heliostat. So the thing that is interesting, we want to improve the efficiency, but again, since we don't have an economic optimization approach, and I said many times that until you have an economic optimization, you really don't have a well-posed mathematical problem. And if you try just to optimize the energy or to optimize things, you can come out with this kind of optimization, but we think that doesn't make sense. If you just try to optimize the energy, and you have the energy that is delivered by the plant, and you don't put any economic constraint, then you will get a very tall tower, perhaps very a lot of extension if the attenuation is not too large, etc., etc. So we wanted to optimize the optical efficiency, but also to maintain a density in the field that was relatively larger, or at least the same, as I said before, 20% or more than the. So we want to have density, high density, and good efficiency. This is almost a contradiction, but this is what we are. So we have a multi-objective optimization. And we wanted into using genetic algorithms. And I'm not going to explain that, because this is something that Clotilde has not explained to me very, very well, but this is what she has been doing right now, with this calculating as variables the tower position, the virtual tower position. Virtual tower position means that we are using this biomimetic pattern, but the biomimetic patterns have the hypothesis that you have the center of the pattern somewhere, typically in the center of the tower. But in our case, we have a lot of towers, and we are not going to locate this in a specific tower. It will be in between the towers, and for every cell, will be different position. Okay. That will optimize the thing. So we consider the position of the starting of the biomimetic pattern also as one of the variables that we want to optimize for every cell. Okay. So this is just how the algorithm is progressing, and this is the kind of layout optimization that we are starting to get. Looks a little like Frankenstein, but at least a little less Frankenstein. But now we have a problem. We have the problem that we are optimizing different cells, and you may get a pattern in that cell that may collide with the pattern in the next cell. Let's say we can put a heliostat in the border of one cell that is very close and will collision with the heliostat in the other cell. So we are optimizing the cells one by one, independently one from the other. So the next thing that we need to do is to have a process to the not a visual process, because we can do it by hand, but that will not lead, because we have to do an optimization. We want to at the end of this do this again and again under an additional economic optimization loop. So we need to automatize the detection of collision problems and how to solve this also in mathematical terms. And this is not easy. So stage number three is how to optimize the heliostat layout. Collating heliostat and neighbors. And we did this using, I think it's an interesting strategy. Using the Voronoi mesh is the kind of thing that you use for meshing in, surfaces, etc., when you do computational fluid dynamics and other things. So we created this, calculated the sphere of the Voronoi cells containing the colliding heliostat. You see the examples here. These are two heliostats that are too close to each other. And then replace the colliding heliostat by the center we calculate the mesh, and we then replace this by the position of the center of the two cells. Okay. And if the distance is larger than the minimum distance, then we have finished. Otherwise, we do it again in an iterative way. Now the collision heliostat, we can generate the Voronoi grid mesh, and we do that again and again. I think this is a process that is working, and it's an automatic process that I think is a clever way for that. It looks like a clever way to deal this in an automatic fashion, in a way that get an appropriate solution. So, the solar conclusion, we still haven't finalized the stage number three, so I cannot show you the new field. And I can show you that this is how it was looking until now. We hope to have it finished next week and to publish this before the end of the end of the year. But this is the situation. Right now we have this, looks less Frankenstein than the previous one. The efficiency looks a little better, the optical efficiency we're getting, and still the ground coverage ratio is larger than 20%, but it's still a work in progress. We haven't finalized this iterative process, and we don't have the final. So this is more or less the situation. Do you have any questions? Well, let's finish here.
You are now going to the direction of making an efficiently operating centralized plant, but I have a question. Could something opposite be done? Let's say, rather than going centralized, going decentralized, for example, that smaller communities, they could have these heliostats on top of and under rooftops, and then, so that would take away the specific land requirement. And then there would be, let's say, just a small area needed for the tower and for maybe the tank for the molten salt storage tank. Would this type of a concept work at all, in your opinion?
I said several times that one of the reasons that first of all, we are not going into the centralized. This is the loop that we have selected, the loop with a specific conditions. I think that we selected a loop with this dimension. It's for a large power plant. You replicate the loop and you can get a very large power. But you can do also the loop smaller than this, and with a smaller receiver, etc., etc. And if it's small enough, the receiver may not be a receiver, maybe just a hole in the pipe. An aperture in the pipe, and you can have some kind of cavity, and then the fluid goes around and then it continues. So this is one thing. The other thing that, but the main limitation, and this is right now with the scaling down this technology, is the power block. It's not this technology. The optics, I said, if you get smaller, you get better efficiency. But the thing is, if you get smaller, then you have the problem, of course, you have the question of cost. And I said, the question, of course, you can do it by doing very large things, and then say distributing the cost of the models, etc., with very large surface, or you can do it like automotive industry by producing a lot. So you can address going smaller, but also producing a lot of units. That could also be a solution. This how you have to look at. But the main right now, the main limitation of the technology is the power block. A small turbine is very costly in terms of steam turbine, very costly in terms of maintenance. When you go to a gas turbine, is you have to go to higher temperature, and that increases from considerable the cost of the technology, and it's not easy to do. People are trying to do volumetric receivers and all the things for gas turbines, and it's not easy. You have to go right now. The gas turbines also, let's say, there are no limitations. We have been talking with people from the development of the gas turbine. You can have a gas turbine that operates efficiently at 700 degrees, but no one has designed that yet, because there was no need for that. They want to higher temperature because there was a. But you can, let's say, you try and you are focused, etc., and you have an incentive. I think you can generate gas turbine that could work 700, 800 degrees with good efficiency. But these are not in the market right now. The supercritical CO2 cycle has this potential of going down, scaling down very well with high efficiency. It's not so clear, let's say, that to get high efficiency with a supercritical CO2 cycle, I think Eduardo Sasso may have been talking about that, you need to have a lot of regeneration, a lot of things. So it's not a. You know, you go just simple and put the cycle there and you get a terrible efficiency. You have to have a complex thing with a lot of hardware, but still, if you do it enough and you optimize the thing and you can produce a lot of them, the price can go down. But right now, the limitation is the power cycle.
Can this technology run, for example, a combined heat and power plant? Because that would be ideal for serving residential blocks, let's say, combined heat and power.
With a, what kind of, some kind of organic Rankine cycle or something like that, or a micro turbine?
These machines are available, but normally they are run with fossil fuels.
We have tried, let's say, with organic Rankine cycle, we have tried before, and we have proposed some things, but at the end, right now it's an economic proposition. You have to look and see if you buy the scale, because typically the you scale down, the efficiency also of the power block goes down for the conventional technology, goes down substantially. So this is just an economic optimization. You haven't found so far, let's say, it's not so straightforward that makes sense, because no one is, and a lot of people are looking into this. No one has proposed that. And the other thing is, it's true that the current industry is not too many players, and they are more in the conventional thing, or very large plan. I agree with you that I think that going in the opposite direction would make sense, or at least distributed generation. But I cannot tell you right now if it's right now with the current technology would make economic sense or not.
What about your opinion just on the concept? If people, if houses had these heliostats on their roof,
people have already addressed this. They are at least from 2015. They are in the literature, even people proposing micro heliostat field with a tower in another building and all these things. So people are going into that direction. I haven't analyzed. I think that a relatively small plan of 1 or 4 megawatts may make sense for, not for a house, but for a community, for a local village, for village, etc. I think that could be in right now. My understanding is many places in India, they don't have access to the grid, and the whole village is being powered by photovoltaic or something else. But if you need heat and electricity, this kind of a small system would make sense. And this is something I think that it would be a good outcome here. Number one.
Thank you for this presentation. Yes, as you mentioned, the balance is very important, I think. That must be studied, because at that distance, 400 or something like that, especially in cloudy days, it changed. And I wonder the heat loss when you.
We haven't analyzed
it. You haven't analyzed also.
So we are still working on the optics, and when we move, then we will move into the.
That's a question. What do you expect? In ideal, this area, or what is the expected ideal performance of this area?
From the point of the optical...
In general.
Let's say, I expect what I'm looking for is you look at the breakdown of the losses. You start with 60. You go instead of 62%. I expect the rest more or less continue more or less the same, and this improve at least of the order of 10 to 15% more in optical efficiency, and that will give a big high to the team, because we are talking about armor efficiency. This is the whole thing.
I was just looking at this diagram here, and the impressive optical efficiency gains you get with the multi-tower array compared to the single. I think you have the diagram with a single tower earlier, and it falls below 85% quite rapidly. I'm just curious because you've got the title of the second plot there is multi-tower and multi-aiming.
That's right.
But I wonder what the efficiency, do you have a sense of what the efficiency would look like if you just have multi-tower without multi-aiming?
I didn't do the exercise, but substantially lower, but not...
Okay, I'm really curious about that, because how much gain you get from the multi-aiming approach as well, because there are examples of multi-tower systems that don't have multi-aiming, like the Vasa solar power plant, for example.
We can do it easily and incorporate that.
I think it would be a really nice baseline to have, because when you have
mono-tower, multi-tower, mono-aiming, and then multi-tower, multi-aiming.
Right, so if you have those nice diagrams that would really show how the different strategies change at different times of day, and it would be nice to say what the value of that is.
We just want to multi-aiming because it looks more fun.
it's obviously better, but it would be good to say how much...
No, right.
Can you please go back to the result you got at stage 3, the last result? Yes.
Yeah,
so what I know that there should be a minimum distance between the heliostat, the first heliostat and the tower. So you can see this in the tower 0 and 2, there is a distance between the first heliostat and the tower. But you can see this in the center towers, so the heliostat are just near the tower. So there shouldn't be a distance between the tower and the heliostat?
It depends on how it should be. But let's say we are now dealing with the collision of the heliostat and the whirlpool, but this is just eliminated some heliostat near the. The other thing, of course, in this kind of concept right now, we are not considering the bath, how you are going to clean the heliostat, etc. But this is also that the. I don't want to go into that. There are people that are cleaning already windmills with the drums, and maybe we can clean the head with the drums. So what do you have?
Maybe I missed this, but how did you optimize the number of heliostat? Instead of 60, did you try to put also 4 or 8? There was an optimization?
Heliostat, we are not limiting the number of heliostat. What we are saying is for every cell, we want to have a specific density, more than 20% of density, so we get a pattern.
Yes.
And what we optimize is the pattern, and the pattern will give us the number of heliostat.
What about the number of towers?
The number of towers, we just decided.
Six towers. So,
well, because it's a kind of a symmetry, we could.
Did you estimate the shading of the central towers, how they affect the whole system?
No, because for that, before we need to also come out with the kind of receiver we're going to use.
So the shading effect of the two towers that they are in the middle is not...
The shading effects are not considered yet. We are going to optimize the further heliostat with this thing and then calculate using Tonatiuh or something on retracer to all the
other losses. So is there any way in order to take advantage to make a tracking and movable parts, so to avoid this shading effect, let's say for the tower, to make it come in when it is not used, so it doesn't affect the other? Or
no, no, but the towers are always used. The thing is, at the graph, there are always some helices that aim into some of the towers.
Okay.
The thing is, there are in some cases that you have a lot of helices that aim into another tower. That is, I think I have something about the balance. I have another report about this. I have a presentation. Yeah, I have something here. This is the power of the receiver in kilowatt. Summer solstice, well, this is an approximation of the power. You see the winter solstice, these are the six receivers, and this is the load. You see that receiver number two is one. And very early in the morning, it receives a very little. This is where you have the problem, but all of them, they are getting some energy.
Okay.
But this is the imbalance that we need to discuss. The rest of the day, this is the main imbalance that I think we need to, because we are going from 1,000 kilowatt to 52. So this is the thing that we need for us. Another thing that I've been trying here, but a second iteration is also to use some kind of this concept with a pin down, system. But then will be the problem with that's have to be analyzed. The problem with the secondary mirror, the secondary mirror must be much larger than the shadow of the thing. But let's say. I know that a lot of people are not in favor of being down, but I am sure that may have some benefits. I also was talking with Professor Collares, and he believes the same thing. I have another presentation, but some proposal that I did that was, it's now a project, but without the being down, because when I left the institution, they took the being down out in Senet. But this had also again the multi-tower system, but in this case was always aiming it was just one aiming every so several towers with several helices at field, but all put together and going in the storage tank. And initially was with the beat down. Because to me, the nice thing with the beat down is if you can, and this is the concept of the Masdar Institute and others, you can put the receiver inside the molten salt tank, then you have a lot of the hot tank, you have a lot of advantage. Because you don't have the piping, it's a very simple system, you are just heating the hot tank, and it's almost a static thing, and I think that would be. And the other thing with the beam down optics is that the optics is fixed during the day. You can, during the day, the heliostat, the sun will move, etc. But the shape of the flux distribution of the beam down is exactly the same. It decreases it can decrease, but the shape can go higher, but the shape is the same. Well, you have a secondary concentrator something in the tower, it drastically changed from one moment.
What is the area for each tower?
Sorry?
What is the area for each tower?
The area of the total area? Whoa, let me show.
It is not readable.
Sorry?
It is not readable here. Very small.
This is 800 meters, and this is 350 or something. The total is 700 and 900, the whole area.
This measures for the whole area or?
No, the area that is measured, I said it, is 439,000 square meters per mill. Less, yes.
I want to ask about the azimuth angle for each receiver. We know that the most efficient is that computer located north into the tower. I noticed that for towers that located at the corners, areas that are somehow directed toward the center of the planet. So, are the receiver azimuth angle directed toward north, or is it shifted somehow toward the center?
These receivers are cylindrical receivers.
Okay. Why isn't there many hills that's located directly north into the towers on the corners?
Sorry?
There are not many hills that are located directly north into the towers that that are the at the corners, the four corners.
Mm-hmm.
I noticed that it's kind of shifted directly center.
Talking about this, why this is like this?
Yes.
Because we have a.
This cavity.
Sorry?
I'm talking about the cavity between 2 and 3, for example. There's behaviors that are shifted somehow.
No, you have behaviors that everywhere. The thing is, you have more. This is the optical efficiency, this is the efficiency.
Okay.
This is the color just represents the efficiency. These behaviors that are more efficient have more efficiency. Then this region has more efficiency than this other region, and this it's because the possibility this guy here that has they let's say if I put another receiver here, then the efficiency will be symmetric. This heliostat has less efficiency or shifted in that direction because they I'm not allowing them to aim to the right because I didn't put anything on the right. Understand? This is the purpose. The this is the.
Why is the upper tower have higher efficiency than the lower ones?
Because the ones here they can also aim here. You follow?
You mentioned that you have used mathematical.
Yes.
Yes. What about the simulation
time?
No,
the simulation time is terrible. The simulation time is terrible. Well, the simulation time, let's say, is not terrible. It's, to do an optimization, you don't do it in mathematical. But the thing is, as in we're exploring and changing all the things, to do exploration is much easier to change because you can look at the graphics, you can explore. Mathematical, you can do a lot of things. Well, it's almost like Python, etc. You can do a lot of things, exploring things very on the fly. You have a lot of functions to do the Voronoi diagrams. You just ask Mathematica to do this. There is a function to do this. If you want to do it in C++, you have to get a library to produce it and all the things. But at the end, we all of this optimization that we are doing, at the end, we are doing in C++. Yeah. And using also high performance computing. We didn't present, I don't know if you want, I can press work on it. I suppose. We didn't present what we did in Flux Tracer, that was something that was supposed to be presented by Victor. But we are developing, together with Australian National University, a series of tools that will be open source. We're improving Donatio, I don't know if you are familiar, it's a ray tracer program that is well has been used before. And all the people are using it. We started to develop when I was in the United States, a professor in Texas. I got a contract with NREL to develop the program. And it's open source, and you put a natural ray tracer and you can download it from the internet. And we are improving the program, but we are also just developed a post processor to analyze the rays and to calculate the density of the per unit volume of the radiant density in any region of interest. And this is also providing interesting insights for the optimization of receiver. But this we have done directly, because we are dealing with 300 million rays, etc. We have done directly in C++, and also using the high-performance computing, so parallelizing in order to use the high-performance computer that we have. And we are going to follow this path. We first do prototyping with Mathematica, with Mathematica. When we are happy with the equation, etc., and with the procedure and the method, we go to C++, and then we go also to the parallelization. And we try that the whole thing to be open source so that everybody can use.
Why did you submit the genetic algorithm optimization
technique? I didn't.
Because actually, it takes too much time, about one time for optimization, and there is a lot of optimization techniques can be used in SID, and I think it's simplified. So if you go through matrix one or multi objective matrix one optimization techniques, I think it would be much better.
Yeah, I think, that's
what. And also, if you use multi objective, you can also decide not only the number of Hilbert states, but also you can find out the number of towers instead of just putting.
No, I know. The number of towers and all the things we can. No, let's say we are doing just an exercise. Well, first we thought that you need the number of towers was some kind of economic consideration. This two towers look too little, so this is, to me, six towers is something that has symmetry and all these things. But and also, as I said, what we want to show first is that the constant may have some right? But no, let's say my understanding is Clotilde has also been analyzing other, and I have seen, well, with the object optimization, she has been doing things, because she's, yeah, I'm presenting the other things that are more mature, but she's all over the place doing other kind of analysis. Even with the pattern, it's not clear that the pattern that we have selected, the mimetic pattern, would be the best thing for this kind of configuration. One of the things that we want to try is to improve, to explore other ways to do it. Let's say we are going to progress from the Frankenstein heliostat to something more. I think the collision algorithm, I think, is looks to me very interesting, the way to do this automatically. And I agree that there are many other options on the thing. Yeah. More questions? Yes.
I have a question about the height of the tower.
Mm-hmm.
And there is for future work, receiver juggling. What happens if we increase or we install different height of tower?
What will be the effect?
If we can add.
Well, the thing is.
The efficiency.
No, the thing is, when you increase the height of the tower, the efficiency doesn't increase too much. This is
different height, not.
Not same. All of them,
yes,
the same.
Yes, it depends on the whether you can increase eliminate the receiver channel. Yes.
To have different height of the tower.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, we have discussed this, but we didn't. Sorry, we didn't add on that. No. Yes. I'm sorry. Yes. Yes. Thank you. we're preparing this conference tomorrow and make all the phone calls about what is going to happen. What is going to happen. We discussed this, but we have not dealt with the. We even thought that perhaps the different Halo that would make a difference. But we don't feel that this is going to be the case, but it's something that we can be expecting. The height of the tower also, and then let's say we need to go to a full optimization, but first what we want is to get some solution, to see that just one solution is better than the current technology, that we can address the challenges of the thermal challenges, also related to all the operational challenges. And then, if all this makes sense, then we will put a lot of effort on the full optimization. But if from the beginning we feel that there are things that are going to be joy stoppers, we will not continue in that direction. So our idea is just to first analyze, can we come out with something that maybe not the optimum, but makes sense? And if the answer is yes, then we go to the optimum. Any more questions? Okay. Well, then coffee time. Thank you very much.